Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to go through how to create a scene something like this. I'm not going to cover the details of the boat. That's just a little extra add-on. You can build one of those if you want. It's a very basic model. The main point of the scene is to create this sort of giant's causeway look with these blocks of stone. To do a texture on them, give a basic procedural sky, have some water created and a little bit of foam around the water as well. It's a relatively straightforward scene, but hopefully you'll still get something out of it. One other little detail to notice is that the stone actually changes color slightly as it goes up. So you can see it's a very dry looking stone up here. At about this level, it starts to become much more wet and darker in color. So I'll show you how we can do that as well. So to begin with, we need to create some basic land. There are many ways to do this, but one of the easiest is to start off with the landscape generator. If you don't already have it installed, go to File, User Preferences. This is an add-on which comes with Blender, so you should still have it. If you just type Ant here, the add-on you're looking to enable is the Add Mesh Ant Landscape. And one little note, if you're struggling to find it, you can see here by the fact that it says Mesh, Add Mesh, that it will be in the Mesh section, and then I've enabled it here. So if I go to Add Mesh, we can now see there's a landscape add-on, so I'll click that. Now don't change anything yet because we will want to change some of the parameters for the land, and as soon as you move or resize or anything like that, the parameters which are over here on the left-hand side will vanish. So we can obviously go through different random seeds. We actually don't need too much detail in the landscape because this is really just the base for those particles, which is the blocks of stone. But I want something that's got a sort of curves around the scene slightly. So we can have a look, and obviously we can modify it as well later on. And you don't have to use the landscape generator. You can just pull and push a plane to get the mesh look that you want. So I'm fairly happy with that as the starter. Now, it's got a lot of detail in it, even though it's a relatively low number of subdivisions. I'm going to put those up to 128 just to give me a little bit more to play with. And you can see the detail goes even higher. But we don't actually want too much because when I've looked at images of the Giant's Causeway, although you get occasional areas where the edges, the sides of them are exposed, the majority of it seems to be a very gentle change from one height to another. So if we change the noise size, you can see what starts to happen there. It becomes a much less extreme change. I think what I'm going to do actually is I'm going to go back down to 64 subdivisions and I'm going to actually add a subdivision surface which will actually smooth things off a little bit. And then, of course, we could play around with any of these other settings. But I'm not going to worry too much. I'm going to push and pull this mesh a little bit. So we'll go over to here and we'll add a modifier and we'll add a subdivision surface. We'll just say one. And you can see that smoothed it out a little bit. What we can also do is go to Smooth Vertex. That will also do something similar. And now, in edit mode, I'm going to pick a few dots around here. Press O to turn on proportional editing. Look from the side in wireframe. And scale Z. So that's actually going to flatten the mesh. Now I'm using the mouse wheel to reduce the area of influence. I don't want it completely flat, but I wanted to flatten this area and then I wanted to pull it down. It's not completely flat, but it's pulled down a fair bit. So we've got some relatively steep areas here. And I'm just going to press plus, control plus there, and then say smooth vertex. Don't think we need that ridge. And we seem to have a bit of a ridge there, so I'll do the same there. Obviously, it's entirely up to you what your landscape looks like. It may not be the Giant's Causeway, it may be some alien landscape. I should emphasize this isn't any specific part of the Giant's Causeway. If it was, you'd obviously want to model it on that landscape. This is just to give you a sort of feel for that sort of landscape. So there we go. That's the basic landscape itself. And what I want to do now is just add a plane for the water. I'm going to put that on a second layer. So just mesh, plane, call up the first layer again, and then lift this plane up so we can sort of see what we're doing. Now bear in mind the particles are going to extend upwards. I'm going to actually flatten, scale on the Z this land a little bit. And there you can see I've got a sort of C shape, something like that. And one thing I did want, and probably the camera view, perhaps going to be sort of here. We'll obviously play around with that when we've got more to see. But I can go view, align view, align active camera to view, and you can see what camera would see now. If I call up my camera, it's in that layer down there. I've right-clicked on the edge. I just press G and I can scroll around a little bit, perhaps rotate Z just to change the view, G to drop the level a little bit, and rotate XX so I can just change the angle that the camera's looking at. And that's not bad. I like the layers of landscape there. And we may need to play around with this a little bit more yet. So we're actually looking across the land in this one. What I did with the other one, of course, was actually look out to sea. So it's a different sort of feel. I think I preferred this position, but perhaps in a little bit. So that's roughly our camera setup. And we're going to need to put a lamp in the scene. So just a basic lamp at the moment, make it a sun lamp. And I'm going to put it over here and rotate it around because I want some of the shadowing from the lamp. So in other words, the sun. But I don't want too much of the land engulfed in shadow. I'm going to set the bounces down to 512. We don't really need 1024. And I'm going to set the size of the sun to 0.01 at the moment. We'll go for a very slight yellow colour and go for a strength of 2.5. This is a perfectly good starting point. I'm going to select the land and then just select materials and say new. And we'll call this rock. And we'll just give this a very simple brown colour at the moment. Put that under the settings colour as well so we can see it. And then select what will be water. I'm going to make that quite a bit bigger on this occasion. Say new under material and we'll call this water. And just give this a very simple blue colour, especially in the viewport. So that just helps us to understand what we're seeing. I'm going to push that back a little bit, simply because that's visible in the camera. And hopefully that will fade off into the distance. And let's just check with the camera that we've got something like a reasonably large number. There we go, in terms of the clipping plane. Because if that's too close, as you can see, parts of the landscape start to disappear. So we need to make sure that everything that we've created is in view. Obviously that depends on the scale of the landscape that you're building. So that's that created. So I'm now going to go to a new layer and just click to add a mesh. And it's going to be a circle. Now by default, the circle comes up with 32 subdivisions. That's way too many. When I've looked at pictures, they're often about five-sided shapes. So that's what we'll go with as the starting point for these pillars of rock. So go to edit mode. I'm going to go into orthographic view, turn off proportional editing, O, press E, then click, and then just lift this up. So they don't seem to really get any thicker or thinner. And by going up this way, it keeps my origin down the bottom here. I don't need to close the bottom, but I do need to close the top. And typically they seem to be quite worn at the top, so we can effectively add some more geometry here to round it off. And very often they have a sort of dip in the middle, some sort of puddle. But we don't want to add too much geometry because there's going to be a lot of these. Now if I set this to smooth shading, that might do it, but as you can see it's quite crude because there really isn't very much geometry there. So unfortunately I am going to have to add more. Control R to add some extra loops here. Obviously I could have added these points when it was just a circle, which might have been a bit easier. And you'll see what this does in a moment. So if I stop there, I need to add two more, but I'm going to stop there and I'm going to go to the modifiers and add a subdivision surface. So this is adding extra geometry. So where I don't have these extra loop cuts, you can see it's just rounded it off. And if I go one more, it's almost completely round. And when I set it to smooth shading, it looks like a totally rounded off shape. And that's not what I want. So I'm just going to turn that off for a moment and add some more geometry. Here, you can press G twice to slide the line around. I don't want it completely sharp because obviously there might still be a little bit of wear and tear, but I also don't want to add too much geometry, and this is already quite a bit because we're going to have a lot of these. See, those are a bit too sharp. So I can press G and open those up a little bit. Alt right click to select the line. See, I haven't added an extra one here, so I'll add one there. So now we've got a slightly rounded shape, possibly a little more regular than is ideal, but we're going to add some more effects to it to make it look a little less regular. We don't really need any more loop cuts going down, and we don't need to close the end because we're not going to see that. So I'm just going to go to materials and select the rock material that I already had. And now I'm going to make some duplicates. So Shift D just to duplicate it. I'm only going to do three, probably best to create at least five different duplicates. So I'm going to scale Shift Z, which means it scales on everything except to Z and make a bigger one. So it's the same height, but it's thicker. And then scale Shift Z and make one that's quite a bit smaller in its diameter, but it's still the same height. So I'm going to select all three of those, Control G, a group name comes up and we'll just call this Rock Group. And that's the basics of our rock. I'm going to add a light into this layer just so that I can see what's going on with my rock while I'm developing the material. And we'll give it something similar to the sun that we've got in the other scene. So let's have a look at these rocks. Go to rendered view. There they are, pretty bland at the moment. I'm also going to add into my world, so I've selected the world, a background, which will be, for the moment, a simple sky texture. So again, that gives you sort of fills in the shadows a little bit and gives you slightly more realistic lighting. But as you can see, these are very, very basic at the moment. Just make sure everything is set to smooth shading. And I think we're going to come down to one subdivision simply because that'll be a lot of geometry otherwise. So we're now going to go to the material and we'll open the node editor. So the very first thing we need to do is add a mix shader and get some glossy on there to make it more like a real material. And we add another shader, which is a glossy. Drop that there. I prefer this method. And attach this onto the bottom. You can see they've gone all shiny now. And for the moment, I'm going to set this quite low. We'll have them sort of simulating slightly wet rock and a roughness of about 0.05. So that's very shiny indeed now. So it's still not looking much like rock. So we need to get an image into there. So I'm going to add a texture, which is an image texture. And I'm going to say open, go to my textures. Go to rock and stone, and the specific rock texture I used was this one, rock smooth 0078_21_S, which I obtained from CG textures. So we'll open that one. Now I can just plug it straight into here, but obviously it's not working at the moment. The reason is I haven't unwrapped it. So let's have a look at a basic unwrap. I should have unwrapped it before I duplicated it, of course. So we can see how well it's unwrapping by opening up a new window and typing UV image editor, and then just press U and unwrap. If you get a message up here, it's just because you haven't applied the scale, but that doesn't matter too much. So that's given us an unwrap. I'm not sure how good it is, but let's have a look at what it looks like with the material. So you can see it's quite okay around the edges. I wouldn't say it's perfect, but it's okay. But it seems to go wrong toward the top. So let's try another method. Let's try Smart UV Project. So that seems to have separated out the top and the side. And actually, that's not too bad. You can see that the rock texture seems to run through it. And obviously we have a different rock texture at the top. And bear in mind, this isn't going to be as visible as it seems to be at the moment. If you want to, you can play around and get your own unwrap on there, or you can just use generated. But I think for my purposes, this will be fine. So we'll go to the others and just Smart UV Project on those as well. And there we go. So we can carry on working on the material now. So let's have a look at what that looks like rendered. So okay, we've started to get something that vaguely resembles rock, but it's got a little way to go yet. So the next thing I'm going to do is add a color ramp, because I noticed that these rocks tend to be quite homogeneous in their color. So I'll add a color ramp and just drop it between those two there. The darkest part I'm gonna have as a dark, almost black brown color. Lightest part I'm gonna have as a very light brown color. And then I'm gonna click this little plus to add two more points. And that just means I can pull these up and down to scale things. And you can see what's happening is that the image is controlling which of these colors is selected. But that then allows me to increase or decrease the contrast for parts of the image and then highlight other parts. So you can see here, I've got certain parts that are showing up much more significantly and certain others that aren't. Or I can bring this up to make the whole rock much darker. Now I don't want to go too dark, and perhaps we'll go slightly more orange with the rock there. And I use a setting somewhere around here. So it's a more homogeneous color, and obviously your best bet is to use a reference image. Try and get some color that looks about right. Don't want too much green in it, I think. But still, it's got quite some way to go yet before it's a convincing rock texture. So now I'm going to add some surface texture to it. So I'm going to go to Vector and add a bump node. I'm going to take the output from my image and enter that into the height of my bump node. I'm then going to take the bump node to my diffuse normal and my glossy normal. If we zoom in now, we can see that we're starting to get what appear to be surface features. It's a bit too strong at the moment, so I'm going to take that down to about 0.3, maybe 0.33, somewhere around there. So we're starting to get something now. There's actually a bit of a problem with that unwrap. I'm not happy with it now. So I think I'm going to unwrap it slightly differently now. Let's try a cylinder projection. So a sphere projection seems to be a little bit better because the way it wraps around. So I'm going to do that with each of them. We'll go with sphere projection. Obviously, you can take a bit more time and unwrap them better. And let's have a look at what that looks like. There we go. We've got some veins running through them now. They're still very wet rocks. And we can play around with distance as well. We can try 0.05. And you can see if I get the light to catch it just right, we've got the start of some texture there. Now, obviously, how fine that detail is depends on the resolution of your image. It depends on how close your camera is, obviously, but we're zooming in quite a way here. And you can see we're getting little blocks. And that's down to the resolution of this image. But from any sort of distance, that's not really an issue. Now, to add a bit more surface texture to it, I'm going to add texture, which is a noise texture. We're going to set that to about 40 for the scale, and then I'm going to take the factor output and put it into displacement. Now, it's a bit too much to start with, so I then add a converter, which is a math node, drop it in there, set it to multiply, and set it to about let's try 0.05. Perhaps a little too subtle. So for this particular scene, about 0.15 seems to be okay. So that's adding some detail, which is breaking up some of the issues with the roughness there. And if you're getting too much of a sharp line, obviously we can increase the amount of geometry. Just bear in mind that there's going to be a lot of these. So we're starting to get there. So the next bit relates to adding a little bit of variation to each block of stone. So they're not all going to be exactly the same color. So we need to have an extra node called an object info node. So if we go to input, there's an object info node here. So I'll call that one up. I'll just drop that up here somewhere. And there it is. And you'll notice it's got a random output option. I'm going to now add another node, which is color mix node. I'm going to add a converter, which is a math node. I'm going to set the math node to multiply. This is just so that I can set the scale. I'm going to take this random output, which varies between 0 and 1, so it's non-integers between 0 and 1, and put that into one side. I'm going to set this to about 0.7. That seemed to be about right the first time I did it. Then take the output and put that into the factor on one side of my color mix node. I'm going to set the color mix node to darken, and then the bottom color I'm going to set to quite a dark brown color. Now I'm going to take this output and plug it in to the top. And the output of my color mix node is going to go into the diffuse. Now you may just be able to make out, if I set this to, and we'll just set this to mix, you can now see that not every object is coming out the same color. And every time you duplicate the object, it will be a different setting. So that's how you get a subtle difference in the color of the objects. I'm just setting this back to darken, quite dark. And the amount of variation you get, you can control here. So you can see as I turn this up, you can see now we've got three very different rocks, but I didn't want too much variation. I wanted it to be fairly subtle, so we'll go with 0.8. So that's giving me variation particle to particle, but now I need variation based on height. So just to check this out, as at least an initial view, I'm going to create three of these, sort of overlapping like that, and we'll go to rendered view. So at the moment, apart from the variation that we've created, they're all about the same sorts of shades. But what I want now is for the ones down here to be much darker than the others, so as if they are wet. And I also want them to be shiny, whereas I want the ones up here to be a lot less shiny. So first of all, I'm going to add a geometry node in the input section and put that up here. And I'm interested in the position option here. I'm now going to add a converter, which is a vector math node. So again, I've used this before. No need to get concerned about any complex maths. We're just using this, and I'm sure there are other ways of doing it, for a very simple way of pulling out the height information. So let's change this to dot product, take the position and put that into one side. Where it says vector, click that, set these two to 0 and this one to 0.5, the default 0.5, something like that, and we can change that later. I'm now going to add a color ramp. This allows me to play with the scale a lot more. I'm going to reverse them and then bring the white up to somewhere about there. That's going to be somewhere around where I need it. And then take the value, not the vector output, and put that into one side. Again, for a bit more scaling, I'm going to add a math node and duplicate it. First one, I'm going to change to multiply. Second one I leave as add. Join them together. I'm going to take the output from the color ramp and put that into my multiply node, and I'm going to set the multiply node quite a low value, go with 0.01 for now, and the add node 0.005. So this is creating a scaled output here. So we know what the position is, we've extracted the Z or height value, we're using this to scale and sort of zoom in on the particular change in height that we're interested in, and then we're using this multiply node to scale it, and this add node to just add an offset, very small offset. I'm going to create a duplicate of this darker node. I think I'm going to change this color slightly, be a little bit lighter, maybe a little greener. So this is a second darker node. And I'm going to take this output and put that into this side. I'm going to control this darken node directly from this color ramp. So what this means is the output should be controlled by the height. So let's just move some of these over a little bit. And I'm now going to take that output and put it into the diffuse input. And there you can see down the bottom there, that's currently where our darker color is coming in. We'll come to what these are for in a moment. If I now play around with this, you can see that changing its height. I swap this over, you can see the dark bit is the lighter area. That's why we needed to swap it. I'm going to change this to B spline, which is a more gentle change. And we can also change this number in here to change the height. So you can see something like that. So that's looking quite good. So that first set are quite dark, and then it rapidly changes as we go up. And we can change the height and the rapidity that it changes with, how fast it switches from one to the other, by bringing these closer together or further apart. So effectively, this is the lower wet rocks, and then these are progressively drier as we go up. Only problem is, these are nice and shiny as you'd expect of wet rocks, but so are these rocks up here. So we need to control how shiny these things are as we go up. So that's what this is about. So you may remember we have a mix shader, which is all to do with mixing in the glossy, which is what gives it that shine. And this is why we needed these extra nodes in order to basically convert the information that's just right for the height of the color into information that's just right for the shininess. So we're taking that number, we're scaling it down to a small variation, and then we're adding a small offset so there's a little bit of shininess on the rocks all the time. So I'm now going to join that onto the factor. Now you can see these rocks have lost most of their shine. Especially if we go up to here, there really isn't much reflectiveness. There's a tiny little bit, and we can affect how much by changing this value. If I turn this up, you can see they've become much shinier. Maybe we want to go with even smaller than that. So these rocks appear relatively dry. Let's go down here and have a look at these. And these are a bit wetter, and perhaps we want to control how much wetness, so we've increased that a bit too much there. Perhaps go with 0.02. So there's a lot more shininess there now. Let's go back up and see how these are doing. And they're still looking pretty dry, so that's good. So the darker, wetter rocks are down here and they're shinier. And then as we transition up, they become more dry. So that's our basic material. That's quite a complicated material setup, I know. I'll just bring that up so you can have a good look at the whole thing. So very quickly, we start off with an image texture. We put it through a color ramp to control what the color changes are. We put that into one side of a color mix node set to darken with a dark color on one side. We then control that with an object info node using the random output, scaling it through a math node to 0.8, and that just gives us some variation one particle to another, or one duplicate to another. But we put that through another darken node, which uses the geometry position output through a dot product, which is another math node, set to 0 for x, 0 for y, and 0.1 in this case for z to extract the height information. We put that through a color ramp set to B spline so that we can zoom in, as it were, and vary how quickly it changes from one to another and where exactly in the height it changes. And we use that as the factor on that darker node and feed that into our diffuse, which obviously goes out through a mix shader to our surface. So that makes it get lighter or darker. And I swapped over the nodes on the color ramp with this little setting in order to make sure that the lower side was dark. We also took our material into a bump node. That bump feeds into the glossy and the diffuse to give you the impression of a surface texture that aligns with the material. And I also added a noise texture and a multiply node to scale it. The noise texture is set to a scale of 40 in my case, and a value of 0.15 for the multiply node, scaling it down to go into displacement. And that helps with particularly the low resolution images to add, if you like, a little bit of fake resolution. Finally, we use some of our height information scaled, in my case, through a multiply node at 0.02, offset with an add node at 0.003 into the controlling mix shader, which mixes between the glossy and the diffuse to give you basically the lower rocks are shinier than the upper rocks to make it look as though they're wet. and that is our landscape material. That was one of the most difficult ones. We've got another little complex node set up later, but it's not too bad, and I have demonstrated it before. So we'll come out of rendered view, and we're ready to do the particles. So I'll select the landscape, we'll zoom in on it, get rid of the node view for the moment, and let's have a look at it. So if I bring my sea level up, now we do need rocks that are below the sea level because they're going to jut up through. But to begin with, I'm just going to select everything that's above the sea level. So this line is my sea level. Go into edit mode, B for box select, and I'm in wireframe mode as well. So I'll select everything and we'll just select all the landscape that is above the sea level. Now what I'm going to do is just control plus just to select a little more, perhaps about there. And we'll go with that for now. Go to the vertex options and click plus under vertex groups and assign. If I deselect and just click select here, that shows it's assigned. So that's where our particles are going to appear. I'm going to turn off the layer with the C for the moment, and I'm going to go to particles and I'm going to say plus. We want hair particles rather than the default type. And if they appear on the bottom here, it's not uncommon. Just select all of the landscape in edit mode, shading UVs, and just click flip direction. And now when you open it, all the hairs will appear in the right direction. We'll go with 1,000 for the moment, but we'll probably increase that. But I will say use modifier because we have a subdivision surface on there. So we may as well make use of the additional geometry. I'm going to click advanced. I'm going to use the default of faces. We'll go with even distribution. I'm just going to turn off random for the moment and we'll leave it on jittered. Coming down under geometry, emitter geometry, I'm going to set that to 0. And there are a few other settings I want to change, but we'll come back to those once we've got our particles up. So come on down to here. We'll leave the emitter up because that might fill in any little bits that we miss. And we'll say group, and then we'll select our rock group. Click rotation and click pick random. Now at the moment, the size is nominal because we don't have any other emitter geometry. So I'm going to set the emitter geometry up slightly. And you can see that's not really what we're looking for. So we need to turn on rotation. Say we're going to turn up the phase to full and we're going to turn up the random to 1 as well. But you can see they're still sort of clambering around the landscape. So we'll come back to our group of particles. Group is actually all of these. So I'm actually going to delete these just to avoid confusion. And then I'm going to rotate these on the y-axis 90. And now our particles are starting to stand up. And I'm just turning the hair length up a little bit. And I'm going to say global Z initially for the particles. So you can see they're all pointing straight up now. We need to increase the size quite a bit. It's not that much. And then we're going to increase the number of particles. We've gone for 5,000 now. You can play around with particles per face. It's okay if these particles overlap a little bit. And I'm going to call the water up now. And then finally, I'm going to come down to vertex groups and tell it to only use the group that we defined, which will crunch the particles in a little bit more. So let's have a look at what we've got. So it's starting to get there. They're possibly a little large at the moment, the particles. So we'll drop the size again. And what I also did is I set an angle on them. So I'm going to come to velocity and set the normal down to 0. But now I'm going to say under the emitter object, minus 0.075. So those are a little large, so we can set the size down now. And on Z, we'll go with 0.038. The actual size depends on, obviously, the scale of your model. So you can see what I'm doing with this is I'm putting a tilt on the objects, so they're all sort of facing one way. I'm going to go, let's try 0.075, actually. So there was a quick render at just 10 samples. I had to just tweak the height of where the color change occurs slightly because I've actually built quite a small landscape. So the scale that I created in the other layer wasn't quite applicable. So there's a little note there. When you're setting that up, you could use just the land itself to set the height if you want to, and that might be easier. But you can see now I've got this darker, shinier color here, and then it transitions to this lighter color that's less shiny up here. We might possibly want to shift the sun around now, bring it round to there to give us a bit more of a bit slightly better view. We can see what that looks like. And we're getting a lot of what look like fireflies here, but that's because of the relatively low samples I've got running at the moment. And obviously this is shiny, whereas that isn't. But I quite like the shadows that are appearing there. So there's a couple more things to do. We need to add a little bit of mist. And most importantly, we need to add some sky. So I'm going to come to a new layer and just go to rendered mode. In order to make it quicker, I'm just going to switch back to GPU mode now. bring up the node editor and go to the world option. So we've got this basic material up here. So there's our output, there's our background, and that's a sky texture. So we want to overlay some wispy clouds on our sky. I'm looking up at my sky. I've come out of orthographic mode because you won't be able to see anything otherwise. I'm going to add shader, which is a mix shader, and we just drop that in there and put the sky on the bottom. I'm just going to now duplicate the background and bring that up to here. And I'm just going to make that a white color, and I'll take that into the other side of the shader. So I've got two backgrounds. One is the sky texture, one is white. And so the important part is how we control that mix shader. So here we go. I'm going to start off by adding a texture, which is the obligatory noise texture. We use this all the time. I'm going to add a color ramp, drop that over here. So the factor out of my output of my noise goes into that color ramp. I'm just going to drag that point down to somewhere around here. And we'll set this to ease, which gives you slightly more subtle clouds. I'm going to set the scale just to an arbitrary number at the moment. We'll say 25, but we want to turn the detail up. So the detail is the finest variations or noise values that you get. Now, if you just drag it, you can only go up to 16, but you can actually type in a much bigger number. And I'm going to go with 32. I'm going to take the output of that color ramp, and I'm going to control that mix factor with that output. And you can immediately see we're starting to get something. It looks a bit more like snow than clouds at the moment. So we can play with that scale, and we can play with the position of that color ramp. So you can obviously control how much cloud cover you've got there. It's also worth having a little tiny bit of distortion just to get slight sort of curliness to the clouds, you know, and you can come right down and have much bigger clouds. The only problem is, apart from the fact they go below the horizon, which doesn't matter too much, but they're the same near the horizon as they are above it. So we need the clouds to effectively recede into the distance. So how can we do that? So here we go. It's one of my strings of node setups again. So I'm going to start off by adding an input, which is a texture coordinate, so we know where we are. We're going to use the generated output on that texture coordinate. I'm going to add that into a vector mapping node. So we take generated, put that into the mapping node, and I'm going to set the X scale to about 5 and leave the others where they are for the moment. We may need to play around with the Z rotation. I'm now going to add a converter, which is vector math, change it to dot product again, take the vector output from the mapping node, put that in. The top one is X, which is 0, next one is Y, which is 0, and the last one is Z, which we'll set to 1 for the time being. I'm going to take another color ramp. I'm going to have one end down there and the other one somewhere around there. And I'm going to take the number output of my dot product into that. Now I need to scale and offset these values a little bit, or I may do. So I'm going to add a math node and duplicate it. The first one I'm going to set to multiply. The second one is add. Take the output of my color ramp into that first multiply node, and I'm going to set this one to about 7. That goes into my next math node, and I'll set that to about 0.9 as my starting point. And then finally, that output goes into the scale of my noise. And suddenly, we get a 3D sky. So I'll take that off again. There is noise which looks like it's on a flat surface right in front of us. Take that output and drop it into scale, and suddenly you can see that as they recede, the clouds seem to flatten out. Now we've got, it doesn't look quite right here. It seems to sort of quite sudden, that jump. And what you need to do is just play around with these nodes, these color ramps, just to adjust where this effect begins to work. And now you can see we have something that's a lot more convincing as a sky. You will get a few other little artifacts, so you need to adjust where they stop. Now I grant you we've got some sort of mist at the surface there, but that's going to be covered by the landscape. Remember, this is just the background. So let's give this another render. So that's okay, we've got a nice sky there, almost foggy at the surface there. We can actually see a bit of a corner for the sea there, so we need to adjust that. And we need, it's time we did something about the water itself. So coming out of that view, I'm just going to turn the particles off for a little bit. It makes things a lot easier. And I'm going to go back to GPU render. Call up the good old node editor, but before I change that, let's just look down on our land. So the camera's looking that way, so it can just see that corner. So I'm just going to rotate the sea a little bit and then scale it up quite a bit, just so that the horizon is quite some distance away and it's nice and flat as well. So go to the node editor up here, and at the moment we've just got a basic diffuse color. We don't want that at all. What I want to add now is a glossy. Now obviously if you want translucent or transparent water, then you would need to add some other things, but for the moment we're just going to have shiny water that you can't see into. That said, we're going to add a fair number of complexities to this water. just to make it look a little bit more interesting. So let's just connect that glossy up to the surface, make sure it's on full white, and we'll go with about 0.06 for the roughness. So you can see that's not bad. We've got a sort of almost looks like a frosted water surface, and we might want to go even lower than that. So maybe 0.03, even lower than that, 0.015. So that's really quite a shiny pool of water now, and you can go even lower. But before we do that, we've got some other things to do with this surface. So the first thing is I want to add ripples to the surface, not just random variations, but actual ripples. So just to make everything nice and easy and straightforward, I'm going to look down at my water object, go to edit mode, and just say U, project from view, bounds. So now I know that that's UV unwrapped. And basically Blender tends to assume that things are UV unwrapped, which is why sometimes they don't work, because Blender's making the wrong assumption. But in this case, it'll be right. However, I'm going to add a texture coordinate node, and I'm going to add a vector mapping node. I have to tell it it's UV because I'm using a vector mapping node. I'm also then going to add texture, which is a wave texture, logically enough. Set to bands, we'll try a scale of 3000 to start with. I'm going to add a small distortion of about 16, and we'll have detail at about 7, and detail scale will go for 0.5. So now what I'm going to do is add another bump node and take the factor of that wave texture into the height. I'm going to set the strength to about 0.2. and take the output into my glossy normal. And suddenly you can see we've actually got waves, or ripples to be more precise, on the surface. So we can play with that scale. Let's try halving it. We don't want them too large because this is supposed to be viewed from quite some distance. So obviously that's up to you exactly what size you use, but we're not going to just stick with these. So you can see there's some variation in them. Perhaps we want them a bit smaller than that in height terms, so gone to 0.1. Better off we're going less rather than more, but that's a very easy way to get our waves. And then I'm going to connect up my vector mapping node into the vector here, and nothing changes, but what I can do is then rotate the waves because I want them coming in toward the land. So that allows you to rotate the angles. That's pretty good. So now to add a little bit more variation, I'm going to add a noise texture. I'm also going to add a math node, connect those together. Set the math node to about 0.1, multiply, and connect it to displacement. And set the scale to, let's try 250 as a starting position. So now you can see, as well as the original waves, we've also got some other random variations going on. Maybe perhaps higher detail than that, go with 6. So that starts to give you something a little bit more realistic. Maybe that strength for those waves can come down a little bit more. And now we're starting to get a much nicer looking water surface. So if you want to, what you can also do is add another effect of water, which is the effect you see when you put on polarized glasses, which is, in other words, depending on the angle of the water to your eye, depends on how much light it bounces towards your eye. We can use the layer weight node for that. So what we can do is we'll now add a diffuse. We'll connect our bump to that as well. And I'm going to set this diffuse to a quite a dark greenish color. So it's as if you're looking into the water and it's a dark green water. I'm going to add a mix shader. And we've now got the diffuse on one side and the glossy on the other. And you can see the water's gone slightly green. But I want to control the mix based on the angle you're looking at it. I'm now going to add an input, which is a layer weight. I'm going to set the blend something like 0.4 and use facing to control the factor. So now you can see there's a very subtle green shade to parts of it, especially here where we've got the reflection of the rock. But for the most part, we're seeing the sky reflected. So that's most of the scene built now. So let's just give that a render and see what it's like. So that's looking pretty fair. We've got a bit of color grading to do, and we need a little bit of mist to help the sea disappear into the distance. And obviously if you had a boat here, you might want it slightly in the mist. But before we do the final render and the final compositing, come over to the render layers and under passes, switch on the mist pass and then give it another render. So having done that, we'll come to compositing. I've just remembered I also need to just show you how to put a little bit of foam on the water. So before we do that though, just go to the compositing, say use nodes. You notice we've got a mist pass output there. So I'm going to add color mix node and set that to screen. I'm going to take the image into one side and the mist output directly. If I just show you what the mist output looks like, you can see there's not really that much variation in my scene, so it perhaps isn't going to show that much. But you can see basically it tells you how far away things are and tries to simulate mist. So I put the image into the other side, and then I play with this factor, and you can see the background there is sort of whitening slightly because it's disappearing into mist. And if I go all the way this way, you can see the mist is really close. So depending on where your mist settings are, if you click this little option here, when you call up the camera, this will show you where the mist is. So this is showing you that mist is actually way too far out at the moment. So if you come to the world settings, there's the mist pass. You have to have the camera selected and the mist option switched on to see what you're doing. And we can drag the mist back here to just before the end of the water, which will mean it'll start to disappear. So let's see what that looks like. I'll just give it a 10 sample render. And now you can see we're getting a blurrier edge there as if it's disappearing off into the mist. And although the sky is still there, it's a bit whiter, and obviously we can reduce the impact of that here, but it's still blurring the edge, and you can drag the mist further in if you want to. What we might also want to do is adjust the color of the scene. So we can add color balance node and drop that in there. And we might want to perhaps drag the lift down into the red slightly, the gamma up into the cyan a little bit, and enhance the blues, and then the gain very much over into the blues to give us a sort of enhanced blue look to the sky. I think I'm going to drag this one down here a little bit, emphasize the red on those rocks, and you can play around with that, get the look that you want. Finally, we would want to add a mask to the scene. So if I add a mat, which is an ellipse mask, I'll just take that straight out to here at the moment so that we can set the size just within the full size of the scene. I then add filter, which is a blur filter, set it to fast Gaussian relative, and we'll say 30%. So it just sort of darkens the edges. Maybe we want to take the size in slightly, darkens those edges a little more. Maybe that's too much. Then we add color mix node. We put our mask on the bottom and our image on the top. We set it to multiply, and then we control just how much that mask affects the scene, just to give us a vignette around it. Essentially, that's the scene finished. All I'll do now is I'll just add a little bit of foam on the water, and then we'll do a final render. So we can control where we want the foam with vector painting nodes. If I look from above and focus in on my little island, go into edit mode with the water selected. Now I need to subdivide this now. So I'm going to say subdivide a few times. So now what I'm going to do is just select these two, because they're the ones that are really, in fact, I'm just going to, well, maybe those two, because they're the ones that are really in the camera view, and say W subdivide quite a bit now. We'll say 25. So there's a lot more vertices there now, just in that area. So I'll come over to here and I'll select vertex paint. I'm just going to set a color, doesn't really matter, and just paint in certain areas, which is the areas where I would expect the foam to be. And that information is stored in here under col is the default name. Come back to object mode now, and we'll look from the point of view of the camera. So we've got some information that tells us where the foam should be. We just need to be able to use that now. I'm going to come over to the material properties for the water, and I'm going to add an input, which is an attribute. Basically, all of this, all of the, what's going on over here, contributing to this output. So I need to add another mix shader, and we're going to switch between the original water. I'm just going to copy this glossy because I want the foam to be glossy as well. And I'm going to copy this diffuse node, put that there, set this to white, which is obviously the color of our foam. And if we wanted to, I could copy the bump in as well, but I won't worry too much. And we can copy the bump in. So just take that up to here. The displacement will automatically go through. So let's just move those over here. Another mix node to mix those two together. Now we don't want the glossy too high on this one, so we'll take it to there. And then that goes into the other side of this mix node. So this is our foam and this is the water. So we just go to normal rendered view. We did all the way over to the left, it's all foam, but with a bit of rippling in it. And all the way over to the right, it's all water. So we just need to somehow control this factor based on whether we want it to look like foam. So if we go over to this attribute and we put COL, which is the default name for vertex painting, and let's just take that factor into there and say rendered. Now we can see we're just getting foam where we painted. Now you could just paint the foam the way that I've just done, and that might work, especially if you take a lot of time and make it look good. But obviously foam isn't quite as homogeneous as that, so we need to vary it a bit. So I need to add something else into here. So I'm going to add the obligatory noise texture. Don't worry about what the scale is at the moment. And I'm going to add a color mix node. And I'm going to put our attribute into one side. I'll put it into the bottom, I think, at the moment. And I'll put black into the other side. And then control the factor with noise and use that output. I know that node setups are getting a bit more complicated today. Take that output to there. So we need to set this one side to white. And then what happens is that when that's low, the factor's low, we have no foam. When it's high, we're at maximum foam. And then just control that with our noise. And just to make it stand out a little better, we can also add a color ramp and just pull that in a little bit. And let's turn our noise value up, perhaps add some detail as well. And we'll change our camera angle just so that we can look at what's going on a little better. So you can see you can vary this around. I'm just going to use the factor output, it doesn't really make that much difference. Perhaps use the cardinal method, which gives you a slightly faster fall off. I'm going to increase the scale of the noise quite a bit. So now we're getting patches of foam. Maybe we go for 200. The patches only appear where I painted. So I think we're about ready for this scene for a final render. And there we are. So we can see there we've got our procedurally generated sky, our water which just fades off slightly into the misty distance here. We've got a little bit of foam around the edges of the rocks. We've got our Giant's Causeway style rocks here that are wet to lower down and here, but dry off as you go off into higher altitudes. And it's hard to see, but we've got a slight vignette around the scene as well, which we can enhance. So I hope you found that useful. If you did, let me know. If you use these techniques to create a scene, I'd be delighted to see what you create. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.